Everybody, welcome to this week's Realtor Roundtable. My name is Darren Philippi. I am CEO of Keller Williams, The Marketplace in Henderson, Nevada, and also Philippi Consulting. Thanks for listening to this week's podcast. As you guys can tell, on every 1st and 15th of every single month, you guys are now able to download this podcast. So I'm trying to be more consistent. And I want to thank you so much for taking the time and listening. It's a really big deal. You guys have been fantastic following and subscribing to this podcast. And you've also been really good at sharing it with some of your peers. Now, I think I made you guys feel a little bit good last podcast because some of you slackers did not share my podcast and I didn't get a whole lot of new followers. So do a guy a favor who doesn't get paid for this and introduce him to Realtor Roundtable. Send him on over to iTunes and download it for him and go from there. So anyway, today is this very special day. I'm really excited. You guys, this is my very first repeat meeting. If you look about 9 months, maybe a year ago, I got a guy that has been a real estate coach for, man, he's probably about 3 or 4 years and does very, very well when it comes to working with agents. I think Bill has been made, 7,000 plus phone calls working with not just regular agents, but top producers from across the country. So I'd like to introduce Bill Jenkins, head of the Jenkins team and a great producer in our office.
Thanks. Great to be back.
Thanks for coming, Bill.
Thanks for having me back.
So I was talking to Bill and I said, man, it's been a while and I'd love to. You've got so many good ideas and he comes and speaks at our office every once in a while and shares some coaching tips. And I said, let's get you back on the mic and share some new ideas. And so, Bill, what do you have for us today?
Well, what I've got for today, because the last time we talked, I went through extensively on the power of asking questions and the types of questions to ask. And one of the things I thought might be helpful for a lot of people out there, a lot of agents especially, is finding out exactly what process would you go through if you're going to hire a real estate coach and what skills and systems would be involved with that process. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of just walk you through the beginning steps of what I'd be asking any agent, because I coached agents that were anywhere from beginning agents to multi-million dollar producers. And the setup was always the same. I wanted to find out where they were at. So basically what I'd start off with is I believe that the real estate business, if you could boil it down, you could just really boil it down to 20 skills and systems. And I'm going to go through those.
How did you come up with the 20?
Well, the 20 were actually, I didn't come up with them. I'm not that smart.
just good looking.
Yeah. And that's fading fast, too. A lot of those I learned, you know, as a coach for Mike Ferry.
Okay.
And I was a coach for Mike for 3 years. And so these were basically what Mike came up with was basically the 20 skills and, you know, and systems that, you know, when you focus on mastering these, you're going to be a mega agent. There's no way possible that you couldn't be.
So do you go through this step just to kind of find out what areas the agent's going to be strong at and what areas need to be worked on?
That's exactly right.
Awesome.
I go through each one of these, and I ask them on each one of these 20 skills and systems, I ask them basically two things. What is your knowledge on a scale of 1 to 10? And what is your execution on a scale of 1 to 10? 1 being novice, 10 being expert. Because would you agree that you can have a lot of knowledge of something, but your execution may not be there?
You better believe it.
Yeah. And that's where sometimes we all have a tendency to lack. We may know quite a bit about what we're supposed to be doing, but may not execute those things. So that's important to find out. And so I'll just kind of go through these fairly quickly. So based on, you know, knowledge and execution on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being novice, 10 being expert, I ask, you know, where do you feel you're at with, number one, time management?
Can I ask you real quick? So yeah. If you're listening to this podcast, one thing that they should be doing, either pull on off the side of the road and take notes here, or just answer themselves and answer them, and this will help them decide, man, what areas do I need to be coached on? Is that right?
That's correct.
All right.
And by the way, it doesn't necessarily have to be an area that you're coached on based on your weaknesses. I also like to coach on strengths because I believe that you build your strengths, you can also build your business as well, too. So it doesn't necessarily have to be where you're focused on weaknesses alone. But, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, I love it.
So number one would be time management. Number two, lead generation. Number three would be past clients and sphere of influence or centers of influence. Four, pre-qualifying. Five, lead follow-up. Six, your listing presentation. Seven, pricing property. Eight, handling objections. Nine, closing skills. 10, negotiating. 11, working with buyers. 12, administration and staffing. 13, customer service. 14, business planning. 15, tracking your numbers. 16, practicing scripts and developing skills. 17, mindset. 18, goal setting and motivation. 19, money management and profitability. And lastly, 20, understanding and adapting to different personality styles.
That's very cool.
That's a lot of stuff, isn't it?
Now, out of all of those ones, out of those 20, which ones do you think are, I guess, maybe some of your key ones that are really, we need to make sure that we have a solid foundation on?
Great question. And the reason it's at the top of the list is number one, time management. Mm. That's the number one challenge most real estate agents have with their business. They're saying, I can't stay on a schedule for whatever reason. And that's the number one thing I hear mostly. It's just being able to stay on a schedule.
Not enough time,
and follow
time,
a schedule. And not enough time. Yeah, a lot of people say, hey, look, I'm working 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, and I'm not getting anything done.
Right.
And it's not a question of, the mega agents out there have the same amount of hours and the same amount of days that
so
everybody else has.
What do they do?
They know how to manage their time. They know how to leverage their time.
I love that.
Yeah. And so, but that's the largest challenge that we run across. What I thought might be kind of interesting, because it isn't touched on as much, and by the way, this is not only good for business, but also, for your relationships, with your family and kids. In fact, when I started getting good at this, understanding personality styles, with my wife being an expressive and myself being more of a driver personality, I went, holy mackerel, no wonder I've been naturally making her upset for the last 18 years. Now I get it. I was just being me.
So you're not totally a jerk.
No. Well, I'm not totally a jerk in my eyes. But at least now that when I upset her, at least I know what I'm doing.
There you go.
Yeah, at least now it's purposeful. Before I was unconsciously incompetent.
By the way, guys, a little side note. Bill's a good guy. We're just messing around. So,
yeah.
And his wife is like the sweetest lady in the world. So
she is, unless you upset her. Then the wrath of Fran comes out. We call her a sneaky D. And we're going to get into that, what the personality styles
very
are.
Very cool.
And what
love
that
it.
Means by a sneaky D.
Right.
And there's four key styles that are in most of us. Number one is a driver style personality. Number two is an expressive. Number three, and these are not in any particular order. Third one is an amiable. And lastly, fourth, it would be an analyzer. And we're all, by the way, we're not one or the other. We're all components of all four, but we probably have two dominants of the four and some that are not as dominant. And we're also different styles when we're under stress.
But you'd say expressive is like the best style to be, right?
Yeah, isn't that what your style is?
I don't know. I can't tell.
Well, I'm married to an expresso, so I'd have to agree with you.
Dude, she's not going to listen to this. Don't worry about it.
Absolutely not. She probably couldn't pay attention to this for more than three minutes. So what we're going to do is we're going to focus on, what are the attributes, first of all, of personality styles. Okay. So I'm going to kind of take you through that right now. So let's start with a driver. And what excites drivers are action. They take charge people. They want stuff to happen right now. They want to get from point A to point B as quickly as possible. Their greatest asset for a driver is they're focused on out-accomplishing anybody or anything. They're very competitive. Their greatest failing is they can't stand weakness. So sometimes some things may appear as weakness, and they equate it with that when they may be inadvertently challenging someone incorrectly. For a driver, the greatest fear is appearing being soft.
Hmm.
Okay. Now, for a person who's analytical or an analyzer, what excites them is reason. They like everything to be compartmentalized and everything that makes sense. Their greatest asset is high quality work. They want everything to have perfection to it. All the T's are crossed, all the I's are dotted. Their greatest failing is they're too critical of people who aren't like that. And their greatest fear is irrationality. They don't like anything that doesn't make sense or is irrational. Now, for an expressive, you know, like yourself and also like Fran, what excites them is tossing ideas around. Hey, let's get in a mix and let's brainstorm, dude.
That doesn't sound like me at all.
No, not at all, man. And their great asset is they're fun to be around. And I have to attest to that. You know, you are fun to be around. The greatest failing, though, is being erratic. Does that hit home a little bit?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
And lastly, for an expressive, the greatest fear is not being liked. You know, they just want to be liked. And lastly, for an amiable personality style, what excites them is a productive routine. And their greatest asset is they're easy to get along. And what's interesting about this is that amiables probably have an advantage over the other personality styles because people love being around them. Because they want to make sure that everybody else around them is okay first.
They're being taken care of.
Yeah, they want to make sure everybody around them is being taken care of first and foremost. The greatest failing is timidity. Is it may appear being somewhat timid. And their greatest fear is change. So that kind of gives you an outline, an overview of what the styles are.
Right. So how does somebody find out what styles, what areas that they're the highest strength?
Okay. One of the things I used to do is I would take them to the four personality styles waiting for an elevator. And
I've never heard of this.
Oh, you never heard this?
No, okay. This is very cool.
So there's four personality styles waiting for an elevator. Now, I've already gone through what the driver is and what the expressive and amiable and analytical is. So let's say the driver. Mr. Driver is waiting for the elevator door to open, stamping his feet. The elevator door opens up. He gets on the floor immediately, pushes his button. He's standing there waiting impatiently for the door to open because, by gosh, he wants to get to his floor. He's in a hurry.
Okay, right.
All right. Mr. Expressive waits for the elevator door to open, but waits for it to kind of fill up a little bit. And then he goes in there and strikes up a conversation with the first stranger he meets.
Sure.
Yeah.
Shows on.
Just shows on. Hey, dude, is this an awesome elevator? Let's party.
The best elevator
ever. The best elevator ever. Mr. Amiable, as the elevator is starting to fill up and everything, it gets a little bit too full, and he doesn't want to be jostled around, so the elevator door closes, and he ends up taking the stairs. I wanted to make sure that everybody got in the elevator.
Okay.
Mr. Analytical gets on the elevator, and as the elevator is filling up, he's calculating the body mass that's coming in the elevator versus the weight ratio on a plaque on the inside of the elevator.
And he sees me on it, and he says, no, thanks.
Yeah, and then he gets off.
Okay, good. I know that guy,
so that's kind of an idea. And it's funny, in the course of telling that story, sometimes I'll just tell that story, and people will just volunteer and say, oh, that's me.
Right.
So that's one of the easiest ways you can find out.
Very cool. I like that.
What style they are. Okay. But there's keys. You know, there's key emotions you could look for, you know, personality styles. Like for, you know, drivers, they'll ask what. One of their key emotions is they're quick to anger. They're very motivated, obviously, once again, by challenge and the bottom line. Their mantra is, I will do it. One of their fears is being taken advantage of and wasting time. And the key words, when you hear them in a conversation, they'll use the words direct and dominant. Mm-hmm. They use that a lot. Now, for expressives, which are also, you know, influencers like yourself, they'll ask who. And their key emotion is optimism. Everything's going to be better tomorrow. Mm-hmm. They're motivated by flattery and recognition. Their mantra is, you can do it. And one of their fears is rejection. And some of the key words that you'll hear with expressives are effervescence and flamboyant.
First of all, couldn't spell either of those.
No, it's hard enough to say.
Right.
But alone spell. Now, amiables, which is an S, that's for steadiness, to be supportive. They'll ask why, okay? And their key emotion is they hide their emotions. They like to keep their emotions close to the vest. They're motivated by what are the benefits. Mm-hmm. Their mantra is, now that I understand what you're saying, I will do it. One of their fears is change, once again. And then the key words that they will use a lot is that they're stable and good listeners. Mm. Now, lastly, for the C, which will spell out D-I-S-C, DISC, is compliance. They want to avoid conflict, analyticals. They'll ask why. Key emotion is fear, risk aversion. They're motivated by correctness, and their mantra is, I will do it right no matter how long it takes. Their fears are criticism, and the key words are accurate and detail-orientated. So that kind of gives you an overview of, you know, what their fears are, what they're motivated by, some of the language that they use. So those are some of the ways that you can identify when you're communicating with somebody to identify what style they are.
So I'm sitting here talking, and as I'm listening to you talk, I'm trying to find out where I fall in the most. So I see where I'm at. How are we able to I think those that gave us some ideas on how we can also kind of pick out the people that we're talking to, and why is that important?
That's a great question. The first step is identifying what style they are. And, well, no, actually, let me back up. The first step is identifying what style am I.
Right.
You know, because if we don't know who we are, what style we are, then we're not going to really understand why we behave the way we behave or have a propensity to do that. Once you understand that, and then you start understanding what are the characteristics of the different styles, then you can start seeing that and recognizing characteristics of different personality styles. That's really kind of like the initial baby steps of understanding personality styles. The power of it, especially with us being salespeople and helping our clients, is how do we identify our client's personality style? And once we identify that, how do we adapt to their style?
Right. That's because I was wondering, okay, so this is good. I want to see exactly how to correlate it. And with connecting this or saying, hey, no matter what, we're salespeople, we need to make sure we can adapt to this. Because I've been hanging out with people for 40 years and just barely recently figured out who I am and how to work with other people. So this is going to be good. I appreciate it.
Excellent. And, well, let me ask you, from understanding personality styles and starting to adapt to that, how has that changed your communication with people?
Big time, especially with my wife. I've been living with her for 10 years, and I thought, man, this chick, she has no patience at all. And I went and had her take a DISC test, and she actually broke the very top of the D chart. Because she was above the D. I've never seen that before. She was just well-driven, and you could see the reason why she's driven, and that's why she has me as a high I, somebody who just likes to talk all the time. She's like, get to the dang point, dude. And so I'm, like, torturing her all the time, and she's torturing me because she doesn't have the patience with me and stuff. But it allows me, at least with the relationship with my wife, saying, I get why she's the way she is, and I am able to allow her to do that, and also I know when I really want to, you know, have her do something, I get straight to the point because I know that's what she needs, and vice versa. And so it's helped me specifically with my wife, along with, of course, managing and coaching too. But
that is awesome. How's that changed your relationship?
Quite a bit bigger. In fact, it was when I had her do it, she also was able to understand the way I was and said, okay. The reason why Darren's forgetful is because he's all talk. He's too busy looking at other people and talking and putting on show and stuff. So it's been very helpful, and we laughed at each other for quite some bit, and then she got on with her day. So anyway, very cool.
That is great. That is awesome. And that's where it starts.
Right.
It starts with your relationships, and then it works its way outward towards business.
Right.
And with your kids, too, by the way.
Well, I tried to give it to my 4-year-old, but he didn't really take it. He just drew on it instead.
Yeah. Yeah. And unfortunately, with you being a coach and running an office, I mean, you're really going to be hard-pressed to try to, fool him with anything by the time he's six.
Right. Yeah.
Because he's going to be, oh, please, Dad's in coach mode again.
Exactly.
Okay. So let's talk about how do we adapt to them?
Good idea.
All right. Now that we recognize who they are, how do we adapt so that we're more chameleon-like to them? So one of the ways for drivers, and what they're looking for is to be efficient and competent. And to adapt to them, you can be efficient and competent by supporting their goals and objectives when possible. Also, by keeping your relationship business-like, using facts, not personal feelings if you disagree, being precise, efficient, and well-organized. Recommending alternative actions with brief supporting analysis, getting to the point quickly, as you just alluded, and in stressing competitive results and growth opportunities. Anytime you're with a driver, if you want to get in alignment with them, use those components that I just went to right now, and they'll be going, thank you. It won't be like fingernails on a chalkboard.
Yeah. Well, I get that. I mean, just while you were reading that, I was sitting there thinking about me and my wife were always talking about who's funnier, and she's very competitive on who's funnier. And though just listening to it that way is just another, even more perspective.
Exactly. So, and that's the D, the driver. Now, for the I, for the expressives, you want to show interest in them by supporting their opinions, ideas, and dreams when possible, being upbeat, stimulated, and fast-paced, tolerating digressions and not hurrying a discussion, trying not to argue because you'll seldom win, being enthusiastic, spontaneous, and casual, explain how action can enhance their image and visibility, and then sparing them the details. So that's how you'll be able to adapt more to an expressive and I-type mm-hmm. personality. For the S, for the amiables, you want to be warm and sincere by supporting their feelings, by showing personal interest when possible, assuming they'll take things personally, allowing them time to trust you, discussing personal feelings, not facts, when you disagree, and moving along in a slower, informal, but steady manner, showing that you're actively listening, and giving assurances that risk will be minimized or handled as reasonably as possible. And lastly, to adapt to the C's, analyzers, you want to assure yourself to be thorough and well-prepared by supporting their organized, thoughtful approach when possible, showing commitment through your actions, not just words, being detailed, accurate, and logical, listing advantages and disadvantages of any plan, providing solid, tangible evidence, adhering to established procedures, and giving assurances that those decisions won't backfire on them. So that's how you would adapt to those different styles. And the more that you become aware of that and start adapting those styles, the more you're going to find yourself getting into rapport with people more and more.
Right. Mm-hmm. Which is really important.
Now, the challenge is we have, you know, once we understand that in the business world and also our personal world, is adapting our style to their style. And that's hard because
it is hard.
We want to be ourselves.
Right.
That's our natural state.
Right.
And there's nothing wrong with that. And yet, when you start learning how to adapt your style more towards the style that you're trying to communicate to, things are going to be happening for you a lot easier than otherwise. Because think about this. If your predominant personality style, I mean, for yourself, is expressive, as an I, then your circle is probably a lot of people that are very similar to you. And so there's 75% of the people out there that if you're choosing not to communicate to that style, that could be within your circle.
Right. So then when I walk in the room, I drive 25% of the people nuts. And I mean, like, I get that. I didn't get that when I was younger and really understanding, you know, me as a high I want people to like me, and I want to do whatever I can to, you know, entertain them and have fun and stuff like that. And I wasn't sure. I always thought, man, that guy's a jerk because he doesn't dig me. But in fact, you know, just because I wasn't adapting to that person's, you know, pattern, I guess.
Right, and that could have been just a story in your head. He was just being himself. You were just being yourself.
I mean, what's up with you? How come you're not laughing and smiling?
Exactly. And so we create these stories in our heads about what our reality is.
Yeah, good point.
And there's how many people on the planet? 6 billion? Yep. There's 6 billion realities, and ours is just one of them.
Yeah. Well, there's only 110 in my reality.
So. That's right. That's all that's important.
That's right.
So the challenge now is, you know, as a coach, is how do we develop talent via coaching and also for yourself as recruiting,
right?
By adapting their style. So I'm gonna walk you through that.
Okay, please.
Okay. So how do we develop? And let's start with, you know, your personality style with expressives. How to develop expressives? So when you're coaching them, you'll see a desire on their part to jump right in before they're fully prepared. So you want to help them with that, and you want to help them sort out priorities. Okay. You also want to help them create some structure. They also have a tendency, you want to support their tendency to be motivated by concepts instead of facts. Okay? You want to cater to their fathomless need for appreciation and recognition and ensure that they see tasks through to completion. That's put a star by that one.
That's a big one for me.
Yeah. And insist that deadlines be met and have them write things down. if you just did those last three, ensure that they see tasks through to completion, insist that they meet their deadlines, and have them write things down, it's going to improve their life dramatically.
Right. Well, you sit there and think about how, you know, some maybe you're dealing with an high I and you're trying to do a short sale. Those things themselves, understanding that you're dealing with needing to get this information and get these documents and all that kind of stuff, and I is maybe a little bit more passive. Yeah, sure, no problem. I'll get it to you.
Right.
And they may not get it to you and stuff. And so I can understand, really understanding who you're dealing with, even as a real estate agent and your clients. That's a big deal.
It's a very big deal. And unless you're communicating with them in their style, number one, if you're trying to get them to do something that's naturally out of their style, if you're not communicating to them within their style, you're going to be really hard pressed. You're going to create some resistance,
right?
And it'll be frustrating for you, and you won't understand it. When in actuality, you're creating the resistance,
right?
So then, how do we develop drivers? Now, with drivers, and this is what you were alluding to this earlier. It's okay if you can't develop a warm relationship with them. Because they're into power and results, not warmth.
Right.
And we know a few like that, don't
I
we?
Do.
Yeah. So you want to let them do their own thing as much as you can. And don't bother them with a lot of details. Help them find shortcuts. Be prepared to listen to their suggestions. Be cordial but strong. Play to their strengths, drive, decisiveness, and force of personality. And help them to be more careful and patient before reaching conclusions. Help them recognize the contributions of others and have them pay more attention to the feelings of their coworkers. Now, this is speaking to me.
Right.
Because this is my style.
Well, you're a D.
Exactly. And so I have to remember that, you know, recognize contributions of others, because drivers, they want to do it all themselves, be in control themselves, and be in power. Well, you have to be careful with that, and also jumping to conclusions. Mm-hmm. Just because somebody speaks slowly doesn't mean they're not intelligent. So don't jump to conclusions, drivers, okay? And have them pay more attention to the feelings of the people around them.
Right.
Their coworkers, and also, you know, your staff.
Right.
Now, how to develop type S, amiables, okay? Your biggest challenge will be to get them out of their ruts. They favor slower, hands-on coaching by a warm, patient human being. You know how tough that was for me?
Really tough, man.
I had to do a 180 on my style. Because, as I said before, I was leaving shoe prints on their backs and getting cancellations left and right until I realized they were nodding their heads up and down, you know, in the virtual world when I was coaching, and then quitting.
Right.
And it wasn't their fault.
Right.
It wasn't their fault. So they're only going to be comfortable when their confidence builds. So that's very important. Expect to do more talking than listening with them. They expect you to carry the conversational ball. Have them think for themselves by modifying their tendency to do what others tell them. Make them feel sincerely appreciated. And when you see positive change, get them to accept credit and praise. They always want to push it off on somebody else because they're humble.
Right.
You know, they're very humble people. And it's, you have to get them to accept the fact that, you know, you're the cause that all these great things happened, and it wouldn't have happened without you.
That reminds me of when I was in elementary school. Maybe this has scarred me, but my parents gave me this plaque that I put on my desk at school, and it said, "It's hard to be humble when you're as great as I am." So maybe I'm not an S. Maybe. Is that right?
Maybe not. Maybe not. I think we're pretty clear on what you are. And that's great. That's great. Now, lastly, you know, how do we develop, you know, type C personalities or analyzers? Well, they want to make rational choices, so give them the time to think about things. And be prepared. They expect you to be able to answer lots of questions. If you cannot, they're going to lose confidence in you. They're very sensitive to criticism, so be oblique and non-judgmental. Don't attack. Focus on the most important things first, then proceed in a logical manner. Do things in steps, bit by bit. Request that they share their knowledge with others, and make sure they share their view with people they would prefer to avoid. That's going to take them out of their shell.
Right.
Okay. And get them to make more time for fun and for people. They don't do that.
Right.
And that's important for them as well,
right,
to round themselves out, their personality. So that's how you would develop some talent when you're coaching and recruiting these different styles.
Okay.
What was a one or two things you took from this that kind of stood out for you?
I think especially each one of those areas, I liked how even though you have their tendencies, it talks a little bit about adjustments that we need to make to be able to reach them better. Mm-hmm. And like, for instance, understanding me, that follow through and writing things down, that's a big deal. So if somebody's working with me, they need to make sure, hey, make sure he writes this down, because if he doesn't, my wife is always telling me if I don't put it in my phone, it's not happening. And she understands who I am and stuff. And so I think that's really important on the drivers and all the different patterns. They all have those challenges that we have to deal with. So,
and that's great. And what you said with your wife reminding you to write things down, she's coming from a good place.
Right.
Yeah, she's trying to help you. Even though without understanding what these styles are, could it come off a little bit pushy?
Yeah, without of understanding course. It? Especially yeah. coming from a D, too.
Exactly.
Yeah, but coming from a C, it's kind of like, hey, would you please write that down?
Or an S.
S. I mean, yeah. My fault. So, exactly. Anyway.
So now that you know, basically, how to develop a talent via coaching and recruiting, you've got your styles down, your modeling, your mirroring and matching. Do they automatically do exactly what you'd like them to do?
Yes.
Boy.
Is that right?
No.
Oh, I thought that was it.
I know. Would that be great if it was that easy? But they don't.
After they get done listening to this podcast, that's all they need.
That's all they need. No, at some point.
There's
and this
more.
Is,
okay, got there, it.
There's more. And this is the challenge. Because there's ways, you know, when as a coach, the number one reason why people would quit coaching. Well, let me ask you, what do you think the number one reason was why they quit?
They're not held accountable.
That's the biggest, you hit the nail right on the head. Their biggest complaint was that my coach didn't hold me accountable mm-hmm. enough.
Right.
And then when a coach would hold them accountable, then they'd quit.
Right.
Yeah. But they would use that as an excuse.
Right.
Because my coach didn't hold me accountable.
Right.
So the challenge is, how do we hold them accountable, but accountable in a way that causes them to be inspired to do something outside of their mm-hmm. comfort level? So I'm going to walk you through some examples here. I'm not going to go through all of them. But there's ways to ask specific questions based on their personality style that will help get them into action.
So this is like when you're dealing with a client.
Yeah, we're dealing with a client. Let's use an example. Every single week when I was coaching, we would have a weekly business plan. They'd all send their weekly business plan to me every single week.
Mm-hmm.
If they didn't send that to me, then that was a time for me to confront with them and ask them why, depending on what their style was.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they promised that they were going to accomplish a certain thing in a certain period of time and they fell off the wagon or whatever, at that point, if you don't confront them, then they don't think you care.
Right.
And if you just let it go, then they're thinking, oh, this guy doesn't could care less what my goals or dreams
right.
are or aspirations are.
Right.
He's not doing anything to inspire me or hold mm-hmm. me accountable to that.
Right.
So unless you do that, it's not their fault. Mm-hmm. It's the coach's fault.
Right.
By not holding them accountable.
Right.
So I'm going to give you some examples, some questions here. And for the drivers out there, you'll love these. Okay. So here's some examples of some questions. Oh, and by the way, when I was before I start this, when I was a coach coaching for Mike Ferry, he'd ask all of us coaches to write examples of questions for different personality styles. And so these are compilations of some of those questions that we came up with. So for a driver, for confrontational questions, what are you thinking? Did you completely forget that you had goals? Now, that sounds kind of harsh right. and uncomfortable, doesn't it?
Well, if I said that to you, how would you feel? Because you're a high D.
Yeah, I dropped the ball, and I'm not happy about it. But that's going to change.
That's cool. I love that.
Yeah. And here's another one. What part of homework do you not understand? Did you take last week off? Because I'm looking at your numbers here, and all I'm seeing are goose eggs.
Right, right.
Well, here's a warm and fuzzy, confrontational question for a driver. Are you happy with yourself this week? What can I do to help you?
That's good.
Or how about this? Look, do we really need to talk about this, or do you just need to get yourself back on track?
Right, because you got D's have the driver. They want to do it.
Yeah, they want
to
do it.
And exactly. You just remind them, hey, you need to do this.
You're just reminding them to do it.
I love
it. Here's some questions for your style. Expressives.
Yeah, be sensitive.
I'll be sensitive. Okay. What messages about your service do you think you're sending when you show up late for appointments?
That's a really good question.
Ouch.
Yeah.
And do you really believe that your story creates a valid enough reason to give up on your dreams?
Yeah. Because I'm really good at excuses.
And here's another one you'll like. I can appreciate that you view multitasking as a skill, but let me ask you this. Would you rather complete administrative items while you're prospecting or just focus on each call and make a lot more money?
Good point.
And by doing whatever negative thing happens, how does that make you look to your office manager and your coach?
Yeah.
By doing those negative things.
Yeah. Because we're about what people think or look about.
Absolutely. Them. So you want to communicate the style when you're being confrontational.
Right.
Now, for type S's, amiables, it's use a little bit of kid gloves, but you still have to be confrontational. Because if you're not confrontational with them, they'll drop out as well. So here's a great confrontational question. What specifically must you accomplish each day to fulfill your commitment as a provider for your family?
Yeah, because they care about other people.
They care about other people. Uh-huh. And how much time per day do you feel you're actually working? And, obviously with having fear of confrontation and things like that, sometimes scripts are a challenge. So I'd ask, what questions on the script are you afraid to ask? And if they give them to me, then I said, why? Okay. Here's a great one, especially right now for agents out there taking listings because listings are sitting longer in the market, right?
Right.
And are having challenges with, talking to their sellers about getting their prices adjusted.
Right.
Okay. So this is a great confrontational question for the agent to get them past that fear. Which listing do you have right now that will never sell at their current price? And if they tell you, then you say, well, how long will you continue to lie to those people? Lastly, for type C's, analytical type. All right, so take me through the steps you're going to follow to obtain the necessary price reductions we just discussed. Because they want it, they're process focused, right?
Right. I like that.
And based on our call today, tell me the top three things you'll implement or change and by what date? Do you see how the language changes?
Yeah, right.
Okay. Oh, so when you analyze what got in the way this week, what comes to mind first? Which reminds me of the old joke of the coach asking the person if he was analytical and they're highly analytical. And he says, are you analytical? And the answer is, well, yes and no.
Don't worry about it. I'll put a...
And lastly... if we don't get your business back on track, what percentage of your goal do you think you'll not achieve?
Yeah, C's will love that.
Exactly.
Okay, so and you know what because I've used some of those, not exactly, but I've used a couple of those lines with other people, and I think what you're really saying is yeah, you can say certain things to certain people, but you're either not going to have the impact or you're not going to be, you may be pushing them in the other direction than if you really... adapt to their pattern the way they are naturally and go that way. So
you're absolutely right. Yeah, in fact, you could inadvertently be pushing them away.
Right. And not even know it. Right.
Yeah. So that's kind of takes you through from A to Z, a real quick overview of personality styles. Obviously, we can go into this a lot deeper than we did, but this kind of gives an overview of the importance, and that's just one of the skills of the 20 skills and systems that that I coach and teach.
That's really, really cool. Now, Bill, you're still coaching, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, cool. So if somebody wanted to coach with you, how would they contact you?
The best way to contact me is through my direct line. It's 702-845-8540.
Okay, cool. So when somebody starts working with you and what is the process? How do you kind of work with them, and do you have them go through this exercise before they start their coaching?
Yeah, absolutely. This is the same process I've used for agents that I coach that are brand new to multimillion-dollar producers. And it's the reason I do it is because it'd be kind of like a doctor receiving a patient and not doing a cursory examination and decided, you know, I got a gut feeling here. It's an appendectomy. Let's just start. Prep them for surgery. So without knowing, you know, what were the strengths or weaknesses are of those 20 skills of knowledge and execution, then I'm really kind of flying blind and really doing them a disservice. Mm. And so it's not cookie cutter.
Right.
It's customized for whatever their specific needs are.
And how much time do you spend with each of the clients that you work with?
I spend coaching calls are a half an hour each.
Okay.
But if they have some specific challenges during the week or something like that, I'm open to help them with that. I just helped a client the other day it's a husband and wife team.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a real challenge with, and she's a buyer's agent on my client's team. She had a real challenge with a buyer who had gone through 4 real estate agents and was highly analytical. And so I walked her through some scripts and steps and skills specifically on how to rein in that person and gave her some specific dialogue. And I actually just had a coaching call with him today and asked about, how did that go, by the way, with the buyer? And she said, it was awesome. I showed him 3 homes, and we wrote an offer on one after he'd seen something like 150 homes with 4 other agents.
Holy cow. Wow. That's a big change.
Well, think about this. Think how painful that was for that person.
You better believe it. You're doing them a disservice.
Absolutely. And they were waiting for somebody to take control to help guide them.
Yeah. Do you do group coaching at all? Like, let's say there's a group of 3 or 4 people that maybe a small team or something. Do you ever do that?
I don't. You know, we do some masterminds, as you know, here in the office. But I used to do 2-on-1 coaching.
Mm-hmm.
I don't do that anymore. I'm a lot more I think effective coaching 1-on-1.
So if I'm listening to this podcast, what I know you can cover a lot of different types of individuals. Mm-hmm. What's your favorite, or the ones that you feel like you could impact the most? What type of agent?
It's funny when you say that. It's any agent that feels that they're not getting everything out of their business that they could be getting out of, that's the type of agent I like to coach.
Okay.
Because there's a solution. There's a solution. If there's a challenge, there's a solution to the challenge. If it's a lack of leads, there's a solution. If it's a lack of skills, there's a solution. If there's a challenge when people inadvertently sometimes can actually sabotage their prospecting. Not because they're afraid of calling people, but because they don't know what they're going to say when they go there. They don't have a listing presentation.
Right.
So there could be things like that that they're not even aware of that's sabotaging themselves.
Awesome. Well, Bill, you've been awesome. What is your phone number again one last time?
Yep, phone number, best number to reach me at, is 702-845-8540.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Bill. I can guarantee you we're going to have you back again. And for all you listeners of Realtor Roundtable, go out there and take action today.